Good afternoon. Before we begin, can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus. I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and leaving the Chamber, and please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The first item of business is the selection of the Parliament's nominee as First Minister. A note explaining the procedures to be followed this afternoon has been placed on each member's desk, and information will also be provided in the chat function for those members who are taking part remotely. I have received three valid nominations for selection of the Parliament's nominee as First Minister. I will now announce the nominations in alphabetical order. The nominations are Willie Rennie, Douglas Ross and Nicola Sturgeon. I will ask each nominee to speak in support of their candidacy for up to 5 minutes, and after the nominees have spoken, members will be asked to cast their vote for their preferred candidate. A separate vote will be called for each candidate, and members can only vote once. And once all voting has been completed, any member who hasn't yet voted will be invited to cast a vote to abstain. There will be a short break of a few minutes while the result is verified, and I'll then announce the results of voting. A candidate will be elected if an overall majority is obtained. If no majority is obtained, the candidate or candidates with the smallest number of votes will be eliminated. And I would ask members to note that if we have a vote between only two candidates, all that is required is a simple majority for one of the candidates to be elected. Members may wish to record an abstention, and no account of those votes will be taken in establishing whether a simple majority has been achieved, and we will then proceed to a further round of voting. I call on Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want Scotland to be a liberal country, where everyone can live as they wish, not held back by prejudice or expectations. Where every single person can achieve their potential, lifted up by a healthy body and an educated mind. An open, outward-looking Scotland, not one that blames its neighbours for our problems. A country that looks to the needs of people next door, around the world or in the future, not just our own interests today. With people that come together to overcome the enormous challenges that time throws our way. That would be my driving philosophy as First Minister. And I'd start by putting recovery first. The people waiting up to 3 years for mental health treatment need recovery to come first. The friends and family of the 1,256 people who lost their lives in a single year to drugs deserves our attention. Those looking for work cannot wait. Or those desperate for a hip replacement or cancer treatment, they cannot wait either. Or a good education, or future generations who want a healthy planet. They all deserve our focus because they cannot wait behind another debate on the Constitution. That's why I would put recovery first. Now, with no single party has a majority, no one should assume the right to this office. Most people didn't vote for the largest party, so it's important their voices are heard today. I stand for First Minister with great hope, but a liberal dose of realism. This country is divided like never before, right down the middle, according to the polls and according to the election results. But it's worse than that. Hardened supporters on each side cannot understand each other anymore. They have stopped listening to each other. And this election campaign entrenched those differences. The SNP often featured Boris Johnson more than Nicola Sturgeon in their materials. And the Conservatives were more interested in attacking Labour and the Liberal Democrats than trying to win over SNP supporters. They both stoked up the fear. It resulted in thousands of people voting for one extreme for fear of the other. In that race to the bottom, we lost out, but so did the country as the chasm grew. Ever greater radicalisation of the hardcore support on each side is not sustainable, whether Scotland is part of the UK or not, because we will need the skills and the talents of everyone to overcome the enormous challenges that we face. And there is an important lesson for those who want to keep Scotland in the United Kingdom, especially for the Conservative Party. There are many people yet to make up their mind about independence. We must reach out to them and to others, to listen, to understand and to act. In this campaign, I reached out across the constitutional divide. Anna Sarwar reached out too. The Conservatives did not. That may have held it together for the Conservatives this time, but that strategy won't keep Scotland in the United Kingdom. And looking after their Conservative friends with government contracts, cutting international aid, a cavalier approach to Northern Ireland, and picking fights with Europe doesn't help either. Far from being the defenders of the Union, the Conservatives are the biggest threat to the Union. But Boris Johnson and the Conservatives are not the United Kingdom. It's bigger and it's better than that. I refuse to walk away from a partnership of peoples of the UK because of the Conservatives. I am here to work for a liberal country, an open, internationalist, reformed, caring, fair and green country, packed with opportunity for everyone, no matter what their background. That is the country I want to live in, and that is the country I will always work for.
Thank you. I call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. When I was a child, people used to ask me, what did I want to be when I was older? And my answer was always, I wanted to be a dairy farmer. When I left school, I went to Agricultural College at Auchencrieve in Ayrshire. And when I left college, I started working as a cattleman on a dairy farm in Moray. And if you told me back then that one day I would be standing in our debating chamber appealing for votes to be Parliament's nominee for First Minister, I simply would not have believed you. And if I've started my speech with a bit of nostalgia, let me also put in a bit of reality. I know there is literally more chance of one of my cows fulfilling the nursery rhyme of jumping over the moon than there is of me winning this vote today. But that doesn't mean we can't try. Because while the ultimate decision may be a foregone conclusion, the route set for our First Minister and our nominee is not currently set in stone. People across Scotland want to see us pulling together, not apart. People across Scotland want a government who are determined to drive forward a legislative programme. A programme inspired by the values that have underpinned our success as a country and our progress as a society for generations. During the Scottish election campaign, Conservatives made clear a number of bills we would bring forward in this session of Parliament. Our first would be to introduce a victims' law, a detailed blueprint to overhaul our justice system in Scotland to put victims first. Never again should those who suffer at the hands of criminals feel the accused gets more support than they do. We would propose an enterprise bill to stimulate the economic growth needed to propel our country out of the COVID crisis, to protect and create jobs in every part of the country, and engage with businesses and sectors who have felt ignored for far too long. Never again should businesses in Scotland's largest city find out at the back of four on a Friday afternoon, just 40 hours before they had planned for significant reopening, that they wouldn't be moving out of the current COVID restrictions. Under the SNP, the spirit of enterprise has been stifled. Under a Scottish Conservative administration, it would be fostered and encouraged. And we would also introduce a right to rehab and recovery, to enshrine in law the right to access residential rehabilitation services. Presiding Officer, never again can a Scottish First Minister take their eye off the ball as drug deaths in this country soar. These are just some of the bills that I would take forward as First Minister, but they're also the bills that we will propose as a strong opposition and a party aspiring to govern our country in the future. Standing for First Minister today is a marker of our ambition, not only for our party, but for Scotland. Because we know that better days lie ahead. Scotland has to move on. This Parliament has to take Scotland forward. It has to be a Parliament that takes on the economic crisis and creates the jobs for the future, that tackles the climate emergency, that backs our NHS with the best funding deal since devolution. It has to be the Parliament that rises to the biggest challenges that we face in the weeks and the months and the years ahead. Presiding Officer, members will know that I'm passionate about where I come from and I'm proud of my family. At just over 2 years old, I think my wee boy Alistair will be pretty oblivious to the fact that his dad is today seeking to become First Minister of Scotland. But when he's old enough, along with his wee brother or sister that's due in just 5 weeks' time, I hope they look back on our proceedings with pride. Not because of what their dad was trying to do today, but what we can all do over the next 5 years. The 129 of us who are honoured to be in such a privileged position, we have an opportunity to improve the lives of people that we represent. So while I'm pretty sure that I won't be Parliament's nominee for First Minister at the end of today's business, I hope by the end of the session of Parliament in 2026, we can all look back on our time in office with pride, that we met the challenges that faced us and delivered for Scotland and for future generations. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Nicola Sturgeon.
Presiding Officer, can I genuinely thank the other two candidates in this election? Given that Douglas Ross didn't express an intention to be First Minister in the election campaign, I guess this could be seen as a heroic, if slightly belated, change of heart. And then Willie Rennie. Presiding Officer, I say this almost with a sneaky admiration. You see, most women, even those of us like me who've been in politics for a long time, would literally give our eye teeth for just a shred of the, how can I put this diplomatically, self-confidence of the man who can take his party from five MSPs to just four and yet still throw his hat into the ring to be First Minister. So fair play for that self-confidence, if for nothing else, Presiding Officer. To be serious, though, and this is a serious occasion, I am asking MSPs today to support my nomination as First Minister, and I bring with me a mandate from the voters in the election. This past year has been the most challenging that we have ever experienced. During the election campaign, I said that my overriding duty was to do everything possible to keep our country safe. And if nominated today, that will indeed be my first and my driving priority, to lead us through this pandemic and to lead us into recovery, recovery of our economy, our National Health Service and of our society. Some COVID restrictions, of course, have eased now because of the incredible sacrifices of people across our country and the magnificent success of the vaccination programme. But we know this crisis is not over, as the current situation in Murray and in Glasgow reminds us very starkly. And as we look around the world, we also can see more clearly than ever before that none of us will be entirely safe until everyone across our planet is safe. This past year has demonstrated as never before our common humanity and that all of our fates are intertwined. And of course, we see that in the climate emergency too. That is why COP26 in Glasgow later this year will be such a crucial event for our country and indeed for the world. Countries across the globe will be rethinking and reimagining the kinds of societies they want to be as they emerge from crisis. Here in Scotland, we must do so too. This is a time to think big. It is a time to be pioneers. Just as in many other Northern European countries, I believe there is broad agreement in Scotland about the kind of country we want to be, a more equal society with much greater economic security, a country committed to building a sustainable future for the generations to come, a Scotland that is an equal partner with our friends in the rest of the UK and across Europe, a welcoming country, not one that conducts dawn raids in multicultural communities. In government, I have sought over this past year to work across the chamber throughout the COVID crisis. If re-nominated today, I will continue to do so as we do implement a programme to kickstart recovery. That will be a programme with the NHS, the economy and jobs at its heart. And we will take an inclusive approach to the debate that all countries must have about how we can build the best possible post-pandemic future. And in that endeavour, everyone in Scotland deserves to have an equal say. Scotland's future must be Scotland's choice. It is in that spirit of inclusiveness and with a determination to work for all of Scotland, each and every single day, that I am seeking the nomination of this Parliament as Scotland's First Minister. Serving as our country's First Minister is an immense privilege, but it is also an enormous responsibility and an enormous duty. And I am ready, with the confidence of Parliament, I hope, to get on with the job of leading this country to brighter and to better times.
Thank you. Before we move on to the vote, there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system. Suspend the meeting. Colleagues, I'm suspending again. Thank you. We now move to voting. May I remind members that they must vote once only and must only use their yes button in the voting app when voting. If any member casts a vote more than once or records a vote other than a yes vote, their vote will be treated as spoiled. And once the voting for candidates is completed, members who have not voted for a candidate will then be given the opportunity to vote to abstain by pressing their yes button. And I will announce the result once all votes have been cast and verified. The first vote is for Willie Rennie. Only members who wish to vote for Willie Rennie should take part in this vote by voting yes. No other members should vote. Members who wish to vote for Willie Rennie should vote yes now. Please vote now. Okay. There will be a 2-minute division. Thank you. The voting time has ended. Could any member who believes they've been unable to cast their vote please advise that they'd like to make a point of order? Thank you, colleagues. The second vote is for Douglas Ross. Only members who wish to vote for Douglas Ross should take part in this vote by voting yes. No other members should vote, and members who wish to vote for Douglas Ross should vote yes now. 2 minutes to vote. Thank you. The voting time has ended, and could any member who believes they were unable to cast their vote please advise that they wish to make a point of order. Thank you. The third vote is for Nicola Sturgeon. Only members who wish to vote for Nicola Sturgeon should take part in this vote by voting yes. No other members should vote. The members who wish to vote for Nicola Sturgeon should vote yes now. We'll have a 2-minute vote. Thank you. The voting time has ended. Again, could any member who believes they were unable to cast their vote please advise that they wish to make a point of order? That concludes the votes for all candidates. The next vote is only for members who have not yet voted and who wish to record an abstention. Members wishing to abstain should press their yes button now. This will be a 2-minute vote. The voting time has ended. Could any member who believes they were unable to cast their vote please advise that they wish to make a point of order? Thank you. That concludes this round of voting, and there will now be a short break while the votes are verified, and I suspend the meeting. you. In this round of voting, in the selection of the Parliament's nominee as First Minister, the number of votes cast for each candidate is as follows. Willie Rennie, 4. Douglas Ross, 31. Nicola Sturgeon, 64. There were 28 abstentions. The candidate selected, therefore, is Nicola Sturgeon, and I would like to congratulate the First Minister on her selection. I will now call on each of the party leaders to respond, and I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I began to wonder, as the verification took so long, if the Liberal Democrats were maybe calling for a recount to save their deposit. But while the process took a bit longer than some of us expected, the result is clear. And despite our fundamental differences on many issues, I congratulate the First Minister on her re-election. There are fewer greater honours than serving the public in her position, and I know she takes that role seriously. And while my party will challenge her actions as First Minister and those of her government, I will not question that she is sincerely committed to the job that she has done over the last 7 years and she is now committed to over the next five. Because for those previous 7 years, she has led a government that has now been in office for a total of 14 years, and she has been given an opportunity to serve for a further five. Regardless of party political affiliation, that is a significant achievement. However, while the length of her party's period in office is in itself an achievement, their record, I believe Nicola Sturgeon would agree, must also be held to account. We cannot ignore what has happened over the last 14 years of the SNP government here in Scotland. Our education system falling down international league tables. Drug deaths have more than doubled since 2014 to record highs. Our economy stagnated before the rest of the UK for a decade. Ferries delayed or over budget. Violent crime rising, teacher numbers slashed, the patient treatment time guarantee broken 330,000 times. The list could go on, but we have to take Scotland forward. We cannot spend the next 5 years mired in the same stale debates and disagreement that consumed and held back the last Parliament. This time, we need a Parliament of action. A Parliament of delivery, a Parliament of purpose, a Parliament that unites this country and leads it in a national mission to get us all through this. If that is the task that the SNP government applies itself to 100%, then it will find support from these benches. But if they deviate from that task, if they put political priorities ahead of Scotland's interests, if they waste time in this chamber on old arguments instead of constructive delivery, then we will fight them every step of the way. The Scottish people have elected this Scottish Parliament, every single member, on a promise of delivering Scotland's recovery. The task of steering our country through the rest of the coronavirus pandemic, supporting individuals, families and communities the length and breadth of Scotland, and on rebuilding our country so that Scotland's economy is stronger and its public services better than ever before. That was the promise we all made to the people of Scotland in the election. And the task we now face. Presiding Officer, let's get on with it.
Thank you. I now call on Anna Sarwar. Mr. Sarwar will be joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I extend my congratulations to the First Minister on her re-election, and I'm sorry I can't be with you all today in person in the Chamber to mark this occasion. I and the whole of my party wish the First Minister well in the months and years ahead. My commiserations to Willie Rennie and Douglas Ross. I've been honest since being elected leader 11 weeks ago about my ambition for my party and my ambition for Scotland. I'm not interested in simply opposing. I want to build the credible alternative. That is a journey, and I appeal directly to those watching. If you want to be part of it, then join us. This parliamentary term, the sixth since Donald Dewar was elected as our first First Minister, will be the most defining period for our nation since devolution. We meet while we are still in the grip of a public health emergency. COVID continues to spread through our communities and the danger has not passed. With the pandemic causing illness in my own home right now, I know that all too well. But even if, as we all hope, the immediate risk to lives has passed in the coming months, we face this huge task of Scotland's national recovery. It is a challenge that will take many years. And it was that challenge which was a rare note of unity in the recent election campaign. The message we have been sent by the people of Scotland could not have been clearer. We all pledged to be focused on recovery, and we must all honour that. That is the mandate we have collectively been given, to come through this most difficult year and build a better, stronger, greener and fairer nation. None of us should underestimate the scale of ambition that will require. We have a balanced parliament with no majority for one single party, which means parties must work together, because lives and livelihoods remain at risk. There are more than 300,000 Scots who don't know if they have a job to go back to. We have suffered an economic crash harder and deeper than the banking crisis. Pupils have missed out on almost a year of school. Our NHS and social care systems, battered but not broken, need support, reform and investment. And in just months, the eyes of the world will be on Glasgow as we host COP26. To meet these challenges and many more, the First Minister must be bold. There will be issues that the First Minister and I will undoubtedly disagree on, the Constitution being one. But there will also be areas we believe the First Minister has failed, and we will not be afraid to say so. But there will also be areas where the First Minister and I agree, and I won't allow our disagreements to stand in the way of that. There too will also be areas where we believe the First Minister should be doing better and going even further, and we will be pushing her and her government to be bolder in the coming weeks, months and years. Some examples of that. The government must go further and be bolder on a jobs plan, on economic support for businesses, on mental health support and catch up on cancer services, and on child poverty. We should be doubling the Scottish child payment immediately, not over the course of this parliament. Right now, we need a First Minister for everyone in Scotland, not a campaigner leading a movement for half the country, but a First Minister who will lead a national recovery for everyone. In the final TV debate, the First Minister made that promise. We will hold her to that promise. The national recovery can't just be a slogan, but it must be our Parliament's collective national mission on behalf of the people we are all elected to represent. So over the coming years, let's be inspired by the future we can build, not the arguments of the past. Let's demonstrate the best of Scotland, and let's focus on what unites us, not what divides us. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Lorna Slater. This will be Ms. Slater's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I offer my congratulations and those of the Scottish Green Party to Nicola Sturgeon on her re-election as First Minister. It is a remarkable achievement to be returned for a fourth term, 14 years after the SNP entered government, and more than 6 years after Nicola Sturgeon herself first became First Minister. To be returned with the second highest tally of seats at any election since devolution demonstrates that whatever differences we have, the First Minister personally retains the confidence of the bulk of the country. I look across this debating chamber, Presiding Officer, and what I see is hope. I see Scotland's most diverse parliament coming together in this room at this most critical of times. I see more young people, more women, more disabled people, more people with diverse backgrounds and experiences. I am particularly moved that in this term of parliament we have crossed what I consider to be a key threshold for culture change within an institution, in that more than 40% of our MSPs are now women. 45%, actually. I congratulate all those parties who have worked hard to improve their gender balance in order to bring in this fresh talent and these new perspectives. This is important because when we change who is making decisions, we change outcomes. Will we, as a more diverse group, have a more positive working culture? Will there be more cross-party working on matters such as a national care service, housing, education, and tackling the climate and nature emergencies? Will we be able to think long-term, to think about the well-being of our people and stewardship of our land and resources, rather than allowing exploitation and extraction? I have hope, Presiding Officer, because these are challenging times. The climate emergency requires this government and this parliament to take bold, transformative action. The pandemic requires a commitment to investment and rebuilding. The majority of pro-independence MSPs returned to this Parliament means that we need to have a national conversation about the Constitution and what kind of country we want to be. Do we want to be welcoming to refugees? Do we want to be a world leader in renewable energy and have town and city centres that are designed for people rather than cars? Do we want blood sports on our hills or sustainable agriculture and forestry? I have hope, Presiding Officer, because the people of Scotland did vote like their future depended on it in this election, voting in record numbers for the Scottish Greens and returning the largest ever number of Green MSPs. The people have asked for practical, life-changing policies, new jobs in renewable energy, warm homes, upgraded railways, stronger links to Europe. We can take many of these steps now without waiting for independence. But completing the necessary transformation must also involve asking the people of Scotland to choose their own future and building the case for independence, which is based on transformation, on building the Scotland we want to see, a fair and green Scotland that is in charge of its own destiny. We can invest in jobs and the economic recovery, reduction of carbon emissions, and improve the quality of life for everyone in Scotland. We just have to choose to do so. We, us, the people in this room. Presiding Officer, I am hoping that the First Minister and everyone in this room will consider the nature of the multiple crises that we face and will commit to working in the spirit of cooperation and constructively across party lines to make the kind of transformative changes that are needed to protect our environment and ensure an economy that works for everyone.
I now call on Willie Rennie.
I want to congratulate Nicola Sturgeon on her success today. I'm sure there will be many sharp exchanges in this chamber over the next 5 years, but let me offer a few words of respect. It has been an extraordinary time with extraordinary pressures, both COVID and political. I have admired Nicola Sturgeon's personal leadership through this pandemic, making life and death decisions every single day. I was impressed by the clarity of the communications, and I agreed with the caution too. Just because we have political differences in this chamber should not prevent us all from respecting each other. And we should appreciate the personal sacrifice that comes with public service and public office. Of course, that personal sacrifice pales in comparison with the many struggles that our constituents face every day. But it is sacrifice nonetheless. So I want to thank Nicola Sturgeon for that service and offer my support as well. We worked together through the pandemic to get through this deadly challenge. This Parliament needs more of that focus and partnership for the next 5 years. So I do appeal to the First Minister as she starts to shape the nominations for her Cabinet, not to appoint a Minister for the Constitution. I want her to reflect that the election was about putting recovery first. There should be no place in this new government for a Minister for the referendum. We cannot afford for talented civil servants to be focused on a new independence white paper when we need the best to be focused on the recovery. Instead, I hope the First Minister appoints a Minister for Recovery. It would be a senior appointment to focus the government's energy. The Recovery First Secretary would use the civil service expertise to plan a recovery that balances the needs of the health service, education, business and many other areas of our life. That appointment would be a powerful signal of the priority for this Parliament. I hope the First Minister will take on this point. But in conclusion, I wish the First Minister well in her term of office and commit to working together to improve the lives of the people that we all represent.
Thank you. I now call on Nicola Sturgeon.
Presiding Officer, let me thank you and other party leaders for your kind words today. And let me also say that all of the words of advice are genuinely received in a spirit of good faith. Most of all, I thank my fellow MSPs for selecting me as Parliament's nominee to be First Minister of Scotland. There is simply no greater privilege than to be elected as the First Minister of our country. I pledge that I will fulfil the duties placed on me to the very best of my ability. I will do all I can with all of the powers vested in the office of First Minister to make our country the best possible place to live, work and grow up in. Now, today is the third occasion on which I have been nominated by this Parliament to be First Minister. On the previous two, my family have been present in the public gallery. Circumstances mean that isn't possible today, though even if it had been, the loss of my father-in-law 18 months ago would have made it feel very different. I miss my family today, a feeling so many of us have had to bear over this past painful year. But I know they are watching, so I hope I can be indulged for just a moment as I speak to them. Being a close family member of the First Minister, a role that, unlike me, you don't get any choice over, is not always easy, and that is probably an understatement. But your love and support sustains me, and never more so than through the various stresses and strains of the past year. I can't ever thank you enough, though I could probably try harder and more often, but please know how much I do love all of you. Presiding Officer, I spoke earlier of the privilege of being First Minister, and it is indeed a privilege. But in truth, it is the heavy sense of responsibility and duty, much more than the privilege, that any incumbent of this office will feel most acutely every single day. For me, First Minister now for more than 6 years, that has never been more true than it has been over these past 14 months or so. Our country is living through the most challenging and traumatic period that most of us have ever known. Lives have been lost, families have been bereaved and separated, businesses and jobs have been lost. Many who have had COVID are still suffering long-term health problems. I have done my best to steer us through, and I have learned the hard way that in a situation like this, there are very few good outcomes, just more or less harmful ones. Decisions necessary to save lives and protect health, our most important duty, will cost jobs and businesses and affect our well-being in so many other ways, and indeed vice versa. I will continue to work every single day to make the best decisions possible, and I resolve never to shy away from the tough calls. As a result of our collective sacrifice and the power of vaccination, we have made progress. But in the past few days, we have also been reminded that COVID is not done with us yet. The virus still poses real dangers that we must take seriously. Tough decisions still lie ahead. And so I do want to reiterate today the pledge I made during the election campaign. For as long as is necessary, every ounce of my energy and focus will be on navigating us through this pandemic and keeping our country as safe as possible. Of course, part of that responsibility involves laying the foundations now for the recovery we all want to build. During the campaign, the SNP published a plan for the first 100 days of a new government. That plan is now Scottish Government policy, and the Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers appointed over the next couple of days will be charged with delivering it at pace. Amongst many other initiatives, it will prioritise completing the vaccination programme as quickly as possible, implementing a pay rise for NHS workers and publishing an NHS recovery plan, opening the first three fast-track cancer diagnostic centres, removing dental charges for care leavers as the first step towards ending all dental charges, consulting on legislation to establish a new national care service, establishing a new council for economic transformation, funding colleges to deliver 5,000 more industry-focused courses, funding 1,000 extra teachers as the first phase of additional recruitment, abolishing fees for music and arts education, starting the rollout of laptops and tablets for every school pupil, making payments to low-income families as we prepare for the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment, starting work on a minimum income guarantee and taking the next steps on our journey to net zero, as we, of course, prepare to welcome the world to COP26 later this year. Presiding Officer, there is much to be getting on with, and this will be a government of action. Many of the policy initiatives I have mentioned will, I hope, attract cross-party agreement, a point I will return to shortly. However, let me address briefly the issue of an independence referendum, which I know we do not all agree on. By any measure of parliamentary democracy, there is a clear mandate for a referendum within this term of Parliament. It is important in the interests of democracy for that to be acknowledged and respected. But it is also important that I exercise that mandate with responsibility, humility, and only when the crisis of COVID has passed. And I give that commitment today. I believe that being independent will give Scotland now and in the future the best chance of making the most of our vast talents and resources. There are so many ways in which that matters. We were reminded of just one of them last week. Our economic prospects depend on us attracting more people to live and work here in Scotland. And yet on Thursday, in Kenmure Street in my constituency, immigration officials tried to forcibly remove two individuals against the wishes of their community. With independence, the decisions that shape our future will lie with us. But I have always believed that how we achieve independence is as important as the outcome itself. It will determine the strength of the foundation on which we build. I am acutely aware that opinion on whether or not Scotland should be independent is evenly balanced. My decisions as a First Minister for all of Scotland will always be mindful of that. But that should apply to all of us. The views of those who do not support independence must not be ignored. You mustn't feel as if you are being bludgeoned towards an outcome you have not been persuaded of. But by the same token, the views of those who do support independence can't be ignored either. We can't simply be told that there is no democratic route to seeking the future we want for our country. And that takes us to a fundamental point. Unity of purpose for any country is an important condition of success. But unity is not achieved by pretending that genuine differences of opinion don't exist or that one side of a debate has no right to be heard. Unity is best achieved through open, informed and respectful discussion and, crucially, by agreeing that the only legitimate way ultimately to resolve difference is through democratic means. Passions will always run high on the issue of independence, and for good reason. But if on both sides of this great national debate we can strive for mutual understanding, empathy, and if we show a willingness sometimes to listen more than to talk and respect the power of democracy, I believe we can and will find the right path, and we will do so together and at the right time. So I know I will not always succeed, but I promise that I will do my best to lead in that spirit. Presiding Officer, building unity is partly about how we resolve issues of difference, but it is also about reaching beyond difference. There is so much that this Parliament can and should work together on. I was struck during the campaign by the extent of common ground between our different manifestos. Even the Institute for Fiscal Studies struggled to distinguish between us in their scepticism about the financing of it all. So we should work together now, perhaps, to prove them wrong. Seriously, though, I have been heartened by my discussions across party lines since the election, and I hope they will develop positively. So whatever else happens over the next 5 years, let us come together to build a legacy out of this pandemic for the generations that come after us. Opportunities for every young person. A national care service to match the vision and ambition of our national health service. Policies that will lift children and families out of poverty and give everyone the basic security they need to fulfil their potential. An action that won't just end our contribution to climate change, but also harness the massive economic opportunities of doing so and give us the moral authority to exhort the rest of the world to do likewise. Presiding Officer, the sixth session of our Parliament is convening in the toughest of times, but we do have reasons to be optimistic. We have been elected on a bigger voter turnout and by a wider franchise than ever before. We look more like the Scotland we represent than our predecessors did. Younger, well, maybe not all of us, and more diverse. More women, more members of minority ethnic communities, the first women of colour, the first permanent wheelchair user. Let us take heart from all of that and resolve not just individually but also collectively to live up to the expectations Scotland has vested in us. Out of these tough times, there is a duty to be bold and fearless. When I accepted Parliament's nomination as First Minister in 2016, I quoted our first Macker, Edwin Morgan, whose words remind us of our mandate to be bold. Today I will end with the words of someone else from whom I take inspiration, the late Eleanor Roosevelt. You gain strength, courage and confidence by every experience in which you really stop to look fear in the face. You must do the things you think you cannot do. I hope that advice will guide this Parliament. It is certainly how I will seek to govern. Presiding Officer, I thank Parliament again for its confidence and I pledge to serve all of Scotland with boldness, energy and dedication, and to do so in a spirit of integrity, friendship and common purpose.
Thank you. That concludes the selection of the First Minister, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business.